गुरु साक्षात् परं ब्रह्मा तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः वी आर इन आत्मबोध वर्स नंबर 27 And yesterday, last verse we saw how Jiva is born. Atmano vikriyanasti buddhir bodho no jatviti. Jiva sarvam alam nyatva agnyata drashteti muhiyati. Atman, the self, it does not do anything. It is akriya. It does not modify it. There is no action in it, and the intellect and the resulting koshas, the mind, the breath, and the body, they act on their own accord, and this is your own direct experience, because you are the knower and you know that the body acts, you know that the breath comes and goes, you know that the mind has thoughts, you know the intellect has decisions. So the knower has to be necessarily other than the known. The experiencer has to be other than the experienced. Yet this unholy union is experienced, and that unholy union is called Jiva. And this Atman, who out of ignorance accepts itself to be the body, breath, mind, intellect, equipment, is called the Jiva. So the whole journey is undo what has happened. And what is doing undoing? Dropping the body, breath, mind, intellect, equipment, and the delusion is being explained now. And here it says, Rajju sarpavadatmanam jivam nyatva bhayam vahet naham jiva paratmeti nyatashchen nirbhayo bhavet. Just as a person who regards a rope as a snake is overcome by fear, so also one considering oneself as the ego, that is the Jiva, is overcome by fear. The egocentric individuality in us regains fearlessness by realizing that it is not a Jiva but itself the Supreme Soul, Supreme Self. And in this way, the transformation has to be brought about. This is the identity crisis that we are having. That we have forgotten who we are, and therefore the crisis. See? We have that infinite, you know, like the waters have been frozen into ice cubes. Same infinite waters frozen into ice cube. Waters don't have shape. The total waters don't have shape, but ice cube has a shape. It's uncomfortable anywhere. Same way, this infinite spirit, infinite self, has been frozen into individuality on account of identification. And now this is the funny character that is moving around. In this way, just as the example taken was, just as the superimposition of the snake on the rope instills fear in the person who is taking the rope to be a snake. Is there a snake on the rope? No. There's only rope. But this fellow is seeing the snake. What can you do about it? Exactly the same way. There's only the spirit. There's only the self. But you are seeing the world on top of it. Just like snake is imagined on the rope, the truth, the substratum, similarly the world of names and forms is imagined on the substratum of the self. And on account of that imagination, that imagination is taken to be real, and then projection begins. Just like first he sees the snake, he doesn't. So what is first? Non-apprehension. What is first? Forgetfulness. What is the first delusion? That he does not see rope as a rope, but sees it as a snake. Then after that, what happens? Projection begins. What is projection? Oh, the snake will bite me. Oh, I must run away from here. Fear gets instilled. And as a result of that fear, then activity begins. You want to run here, you want to run there, you want to save yourself, you want to climb a tree. And in this way, Rajju Sarpa Vadatmanam Jivam Nyatva Bhayam Vahet. This delusory, this person who has got deluded by the rope, which is actually a snake, goes through the symptoms of fear. And not only to that extent, if by mistake he puts his foot on a rope and the rope curls up and touches his leg, he feels he has been bitten by the snake and he will have all the symptoms of a snake bite. This is seen. And then someone going, passing by, sees this fellow's misery, Guru Maharaj, and he looks at him, hey, what happened? Oh, please save me, please take me to the doctor, please take me to the Vaidya, I have been bitten by a snake, this, that, blah, 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 blah. All symptoms, froth coming out, why? Poison is spreading into my body. He's imagining the poison is spreading. He can't move his leg, oh my God. And then the Guru Maharaj, or the passerby who is now the Guru, he brings his attention that, Aray, Maharaj, this is not a snake, this is a rope. See, I am lifting it. Immediately the symptom, all the symptoms on account of the snake start reducing. Exactly the same way with us also, or with this jiva. Guru Maharaj comes into our life, brings our attention to, hello, you are not the jiva, you are the infinite self. Look, because he has realized, he shows the fearlessness, he explains, and as a result of interacting with that information, reflection and contemplation on that information, the effect of ignorance, it starts reducing. So first is non-apprehension, then is misapprehension. First is forgetfulness of the real thing, and second thing is being deluded by the something, and the second thing is projection. So first, man is happy, then first fall, first delusion. He feels, what is the point living whole life by myself? And he sees, starts projection. Which one is my life partner? With whom can I be happy for the rest of my life? Starts looking for, looks around, so many people are happy. Doesn't happen. Projection. Then he starts projecting, this can be my wife, this can be my wife, this can be my wife, or this can be my husband, this can be my husband. Projection. In Panchadashi, one example comes. there are 10 people going on a pilgrimage. They want to go to Kailash and they begin from the house. The first obstacle that they get is a river. The river is flowing. And the river is, the water level is a little bit high. So they all hold each other's hand and somehow with great difficulty the water is up to their necks and somehow they cross the river. There are 10 of them. When they cross, they are not, everyone counts. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. All 10 count all of them. And they come to the conclusion that we are only 9. I think we have lost one person in the river. And we have just begun our journey and already a casualty. And they are brooding, crying on their fate and my God, how, if this is the beginning, maybe it's an auspicious time. See, projection, it's an auspicious time. Maybe we should go back. Maybe we should do this. Maybe we should do that. At that time, when Maharaj was going by, he says, why are you all crying? All men look so young and strong and everything. What happened? Oh, we were crossing the river, we are going on a pilgrimage, and the first casualty has happened while coming out. Every one of us counted, but we are only 9 of us now. That Maharaj looked at everyone and gave a smile. He smiled. The moment he smiled, they all looked at him. Why are you smiling, sir? He called one. Come here. Count. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. He said, did you count yourself? He counted himself 10. Immediately, the delusion was gone of the loss of one person. Instruction was given to one, but all the other 9 also got realized. See, we are forgetting ourselves, just like they forgot themselves to be included in the count. So first was a delusion that they have lost one person, then projection. And this is what we are doing. We are and because of this delusion, man, the individual, he suffers throughout his life, considering himself to be the body, breath, mind, intellect, taking himself to be this empirical body, and then projecting what? Doesn't stop. First thing is he has forgotten who he is. Then he projects that he is the body. Then he doesn't stop there. From there he continues further, as if that was not enough. What is that second projection? I am the father, I am the brother, I am the son, I am the friend, I am the employee, I am this, I am that. Second projection. Projection, and within the projection another projection. That deep the rabbit hole goes. And in this way, who is a realized master? He who from whom this delusion has been removed, and that is on account of detachment from the matter, equipment, which he is considering as his own. And this comes about by focusing on the substratum, focusing on the self. Atma vabhasa yat yeko buddhyadinindriyanyapi दीपो घटादिवत् स्वात्मा जडैस्तैर्नाव भास्यते. Here he says, Just as a lamp illumines a jar or a pot, so also the Atman illumines the mind and the sense organs, etc. These material objects by themselves cannot illumine themselves because they are inert. Yesterday we talked in detail about it. Just as the sun is illuminating the whole world, this light is illuminating all the objects on in this room, so also the Atman, the self, it is illuminating all the matter equipments. Look at it from this point of view. Majority of the people, they live in this world thinking this world is the result of the sun around whom the earth is going around, isn't it? That is our perception. So sun, Surya Devata. And there are so many sadhanas. You contemplate Om Bhurbhuvah Svah Tat Savitur Varenyam, and all those chantings are there. Chant 1 lakh times, 2 lakh times, and all the power of the sun will be yours, and his blessings will be yours, this, that, blah, blah, blah. But never the man thinks, can a lamp illuminate the sun? Can the lamp illuminate the sun? No, okay. So, sun is the most powerful. Is there anything that can illuminate the sun in this creation? No? Bindi? Who can illuminate the sun? No? Think again. Is there anything that can illuminate the sun? This light is illuminating this room. Is there anything in this room that can illuminate the light? Simple question.
You said in this creation.
Okay, I'm just taking simile. Take the creation. In this creation, in your immediate, whatever you are seeing, is there anything?
Well,
how?
Through observing.
Okay, good. So the sun is illuminated by your eyes. So which is more powerful? The sun or the eyes? So in our scriptures it is told the right eye is the sun and the left eye is the moon. So both, everything that is out there has to be in micro also. Who is illuminating this sun and the moon? The mind. Who is illuminating the mind? The self. Be that eternal light. Be that original source. See? This comes through observation. And therefore this example is taken, just as a lamp illumines a jar or a pot, so also the Atman illumines the mind and the sense organs, etc. Because this Atman is self-effulgent, it is the one without a second, and matter equipment, all the name and form, is inert by nature. See, even here, you can see, even though the light is there, you can see the sunlight coming and shining there, isn't it? It's only because there is reflection you are able to see it. You are not seeing the original light. Similarly, everything that is being observed in this creation by you, you are not seeing the sun. You are seeing the sunlight reflecting upon the surface of the object, and then you are able to cognize. Similarly, that sun also you are able to cognize because the rays of your vision are reflecting on the sun. You are able to observe the senses because the rays of the mind are reflecting on the senses. Go further back. The rays of the consciousness, the light of consciousness that the self is, that is illuminating the thoughts. Because every thought has the I thought. Without the I thought, the object cannot be known. In this way, contemplate. What is intellect? Intellect is the summation of the total past that you are at this moment. And it has to be given up. Who are you? I am Shantam, I am Swami Paramananda. How did you get to be Swami Paramananda? Wait, thank you for asking the question. I'll start. You want to start from this life or last life? So, birth and death is not in the I. Beginning and end is in the matter. But I takes on, gets identified with the matter and starts thinking, I am also born and I also die. Even if it is, the I is thinking of itself as a thought, because the I thought is there, no? It also begins and it also ends. See? With every interaction. And that continuity, imagined continuity of the I as a thought, as a thought. I is continuous principle, that is the self, isn't it? But I as a thought cannot be continuous. I know Anjali is one thought or one interaction, then I know Shantam is second one. The I know which came in this interaction and I know which came in this interaction are two separate ones. The waker yesterday and the waker today are two different ones. But we take them to be continuous, and that is what is creating the problem. In dream we don't take it continuous, but here we take it continuous. So correct the error. Put antivirus. What is antivirus? Contemplate on the self. Atma Bodha is the antivirus. Thinking in this manner is the antivirus. It will remove the corruption. So these matter equipments, they borrow the power, the energy, the light. Just like all objects here are borrowing the light from the lamp, and then revealing themselves to us, exactly the same way. All thoughts, all matter equipment are borrowing the light from the self, and then only we are able to know them. Otherwise we can't, including the I thought. And in this way, contemplate. Then it says, स्वबोधे नान्य बोधेच्छा बोधरूपतयात्मनः न दीपस्यान्य दीपेच्छा यथा स्वात्म प्रकाशने. See, our experience there has never been a moment in our life where we have got identified, the self has got identified with the matter equipments, where the self has got identified with the thoughts. How can you say that we have never got identified? Just now you are talking about disidentify, and now you are saying you are not identified. That is the original position. Then where is identification? Only in your imagination. Only in our imagination. See? And if you catch this point, then no thought is a problem. No thought. No thought of the future is problem. No thought in the present is problem. No thought of the past memory is a problem. Why would it become a problem? Because you are not the thought. You are the illuminator of the thought. And that is your original position. You don't say when you are standing on the roadside on Springvale Road, I am the car. Because just because you saw the car. Do you? So much traffic is going on. You don't say, I am this, oh, I am BMW. Oh, no, 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 no. I am the Mercedes. No, you just pass. Let the traffic go. The moment traffic is over, cross over, isn't it? The traffic of thoughts is going through. There is a highway. That is called mind. Continuously the thoughts coming and going, coming and going. You are watching, that's why you know there are thoughts coming and going. Otherwise, how will you make that statement that there are thoughts in my mind? You must be the knower of the thoughts. But somewhere something happens. And we start projecting. We get identified. We imagine this identification. We forget our original position, which is we are the witness. Instead, we take the we get identified by giving it value and attention. That's the accident that has happened. So undo that. Undo the identification. So no thought of past, present or future should be a problem to us. If you remember this, that you are the illuminator of the thoughts. They should not be. We should not give the power to the matter equipments to persecute us. Because if we are miserable, because we have chosen to be. Because we are given power to the thought. We are given the power to the imagination. That to something else other than the self. Therefore we are miserable. That's the identity crisis that has taken place. Get out of it. And nothing has to be spoken to anyone. In your own heart and in your mind, become convinced, I am the one. Why am I unnecessarily allowing myself to be persecuted by what I am illuminating? See? Take the power back. Don't give the power to the name and form. Thought is also a name and form. It also has a form. It is also the words. So now in the 29th verse, how self is self-illumined, self-asserted. This is told here. It says, a lighted lamp does not need another lamp to illuminate its light. So too, Atman, which is knowledge itself, needs no other knowledge to know it. We are addicted to, because of our obsession with name and form, because of our obsession with matter equipments and considering ourselves to be the matter equipments, body, breath, mind, intellect. Therefore, the only knowledge we know is that we cram into our head, into our mind. By repetition, by interaction, by giving value to the thoughts, by giving a status of importance to the thoughts, by giving attention to the thoughts. And if the thoughts, and if I can't remember something, oh my God, I'm losing my mind, this, that, and all these statements come out. Just like sun does not need anything else to illuminate it, similarly, the self also is self-illumined. It does not, it cannot be illumined by any thought. Can the reflection, no, I shouldn't say that one. Hmm? no other light I gave you in advance. I gave you the example of the eyes are illuminating the sun, but look at it from the relative standpoint. No other lamp or candle can illuminate, or a torchlight can illuminate the sun. It is self-illumined. Now leave the previous example aside. Otherwise, don't pull it here. Nothing can illuminate the sun. It is self-illumined. Exactly the same way, this Atman is also self-illumined. No thought can give you the knowledge of the self. No thought. Then, what does self-illumining mean? Illumined mean? It means knowing less knowing. It means wisdom. So, is there knowledge? That also can be not knowledge? Yes, knowledge without thoughts. That knowing we are talking about. And for this I make one statement. I think, therefore I am, or I am, therefore thinking happens. Modern psychiatrists, they say, I think, therefore I am. Some Descartes confused the whole world after saying that. I think, therefore I am. And what is your experience? I am, therefore I don't think. Thinking happens. I'm very careful by using that. I am, therefore thinking happens. And if thinking does not happen, I continue to be. Isn't it? Take that position. Take it deep into you, so that by default you are in that position all the time. It should be initially something happens, and after few days or after few moments or after few hours you will come back to, why did I? But it must go so deep that by mistake also you lose your original position, bang, you come back again. In boxing, you punch, you are not allowed to keep the, the hand there. You punch, because opponent is there, the hand goes out. But it must immediately come back to original position. Split of a second, like a lightning swing, bam. See? And that is what is happening. Now you will start thinking, the self goes out and then comes back. No, we are talking about relatively now. The I, thought, interacts with some object and comes back to original position. Then again it goes out and interacts with some object, then comes back to original position. That is the gap between the two. Without coming back to original position, so it went out, the rays went out of the eye and it came back, isn't it? I'm talking about the reflection now. I'm not talking about the original. So keep how quickly you come back to yourself. Before you make a comment, oh my God, I did that, I did this, immediately. If it is persecuting you, if it is troubling you, if it is making you emotional, if you are feeling guilty, if you are whatever, if it is taking you away from your poise, that you have become convinced in your mind that you are that original, you are that illuminator, you are the conscious principle, you are the self-illumined, you are not the mind, you are not the breath, you are not the body, you are not the decisions, which are also nothing but thoughts. If that has become very clear, then it does not matter. When someone came to Swamiji and he said, Swamiji was taking his interview, a sannyasi, he came, Swamiji said, if you have to attend, study the Vedanta class, wanted to study Vedanta, came from far away. Swamiji said, you may be a sannyasi, I respect, I am also a sannyasi, but all the students are there, they will start getting distracted by you. I want all the students to be the same. In what sense? At least externally. Everyone has to wear white. That sannyasi, young fellow, being a sannyasi, he was attached to the color of the cloth. Who is sannyasi? Who has renounced everything. See the drama. Sannyasi is, he has renounced. Samyak nyasa, he is equanimous, does not react to anything, does not hold on to anything, holding on to his cloth. He didn't do for the sake of the cloth, he missed the opportunity of studying the scriptures. See? So don't take any position in life. At the relative level, sannyas is good, but in the mind, sannyas is also a part of the whole thing. Idea that I am a renunciate, that also must go. It's helpful in the initial stages. Yes, of course it is. That I belong to this sampradaya, that sampradaya, I am a vegetarian, non-vegetarian, I am rich or poor, I am intelligent or buddhu. All these things must not have an impact on us. Absolutely not. Vegan. I don't drink. Some people say, I live only on milk. Some people say, I don't drink milk. Don't take any position. Growth means you are comfortable in every circumstance that life presents to you. And that comfort, that poise will only come not by focusing on the world. It will come by being the one who is illuminating all that. That is Atmabodha. Don't come down from that position. In spite of everything is going on. Sometimes by default irritation comes. Inside we must be very clear that the irritation is of the mind. Let it express. If it has got irritated, it will come back to normal also. If it is sleepy, it will wake up also. If it is awake, it will sleep also. There is no permanent position in the matter. Permanent position is only in the self, as the self. In matter, nothing is permanent. Everything is changing. Your convictions have changed all your life. Theories have changed. World has changed. What are you going to hold on with your matter equipment? Nothing can be held on to. Svabodhe nanya bodhecha bodho rupatayatmanaha na deepasyat. Yatha swatma prakashane. So too the Atman, which is knowledge itself, needs no other knowledge to know it. Which is this no other knowledge? It is the thought knowledge. No thought knowledge can reveal the self knowledge. Then what are we doing? Are we revealing self knowledge? No, we are only convincing the mind that this is what its nature is. We are not talking about, we are not telling, I want the self to be revealed, I want to. You are the self. How can you ask the self to reveal? You are the self. And the whole journey is for the mind to realize that it is essentially, because it is thought fixated, it is addicted to thoughts, that is its nature, what can you do? Mind's job is to think. But what is it thinking about? What is it thinking about? It's thinking about everything other than the self. That's why the discomfort. That's why the crisis. Crisis not in the self. Crisis is identity crisis is not in the self. The identity crisis is in the imagination. and that is the mind. In the mind is the imagination. So somewhere mind and intellect has decided, I am the body. Somewhere deep inside, so this conviction has come to it. Maybe from past life, habit. And this is how it has begun. We find ourselves in this life as this body. Now undo it. Opportunity is only this life. Before death it must happen. Death of this body. It must happen. What? That you take the original position. You don't be the mind. You don't be the... Recognize that they are only the equipments. So in this manner, only as long as at the seeker level, at the individual level, as long as I am looking out, as long as I am extrovert, the world is real. As I take the power back, my attention, instead of going out into the world, comes to the body, yoga begins. Then I am not satisfied with that. Then I want to go further within, come to the breath, pranayama begins. Then that is not enough. Go further within, come to the mind, japa begins. That is also not enough. As a result of all this, each one is feeding the next stage. You come, because your attention is, who am I? What is this source? What is that talking about? Come back, come to the intellect, contemplation begins. Samadhi happens. And if the attention is still the atmic self, the Atman, then Sahaja Bhava will express automatically. Because we were introvert, our attention initially was going out, the multiplicity feeds multiplicity. But when we become introvert, all that same mind which was becoming multi-pointed, getting distracted by the various names and forms, has become focused and come back to the source. Automatically the mind has become calm. Then the example was given before, that if the waves on the ocean are calm, the moon reflects. You are not creating the reflection of the moon, you are only subsiding the waves. So when we shift our attention towards the Atman, then the thought eruptions in the mind will automatically start subsiding. That is the only way. You can force yourself, no doubt. There are many, many different ways you can do it. But you want a permanent abidance in yourself, in the self, then you have to think about that goal, that you have to think about that self. And when the mind subsides, automatically the reflection of the self is cognized, and that gives you a feeling of bliss. Ah, it was such a wonderful meditation, it was such a wonderful satsang, it was such a wonderful sitting. I want to experience that again. Everyone wants to be the immaculate self, because they are by nature that. But only imagining that they are not, because attention is on the conditionings. Someone told, Rumi said, what did he say? When the self sought the God, searched for the God, and when he reached there, he found self only. And the God when he came to the seeker, he found that the self was not there, only God was there. So whether the individual self, the wave searches for the ocean, wave is going with the concept in the mind, I am water, I am water, I am water, I have to become the water, I have to become the water, I have to merge into the water, I have to realize the water. It is, the journey has begun. And when it reaches the water, what does it realize? I am already the water.
निषिध्य निखिलोपाधीन नेति नेतीति वाक्यतः विद्या दैक्यं महावाक्यैः जीवात्म परमात्मनोः.
He says, by a process, now here the method of neti neti is being explained, not this, not this. By a process of negation of the conditionings, the upadhis, through the help of the scriptural statements, it is not this, it is not this, the oneness of the individual soul and the supreme soul, that means the jiva and the paramatma, or Brahman, as indicated by the great Mahavakyas, has to be realized. What is the Mahavakya that the teacher tells you, or the Upanishads tell you? Tattvamasi, you are that. You are that. So who is you? The individual consciousness. What is that? The infinite consciousness. Come down a level. Come down, absolutely come down to a level. You are wife, you are husband, and you are being told. And these are told also. People have come here, they say, Swamiji, we are separating, this happened, I am feeling so sad, this, that. What you are feeling sad for? Separation. Who is feeling sad? I am. Which I? The husband I? The man I? Which one? Oh no, now what will happen? To whom what will happen? If you are still thinking about the person, then you are the husband or you are the wife, isn't it? Who is miserable? The husband or the wife, the role that you have taken, the identity that you have taken on account of something, that identity, that fictitious identity is miserable. But now divorce has taken place. Where has that identity gone? Where has the husband gone? Find out. Husband was also you, the man is also you, isn't it? So, stop being the husband. Be the man. But sir, I am already the man. Why you are giving me the instruction that be the man, be a man? We are not talking about manliness, huh? We are talking about the person. If he gets married again, he will start calling himself husband. So, who is miserable? The projection is miserable, isn't it? See? So here, when the instruction is given, Tattvamasi, you are that, you the individual are that, the infinite. You the husband are that, the man. You the wife are that, the, the woman. And what is this, are? Thou art that, you are that. What is that R? R is the common denominator which is connecting the two. The isness, the existence. Husband also was existing, man is also existing. But your attention from the identification and coming back to the original position. This is being told by this statement that Tattvamasi, contemplate on that. And when he starts contemplating that, man, yes, I am not the body, I am not the breath. First he gives up. In Panchadashi this thought comes. Primary self, secondary self. What is the secondary self? Secondary self is husband, wife, brother, sister, daughter, etc., etc. Double superimposition. Imagination within an imagination. So first imagination is, I am the body. Second imagination is, I am the husband, I am a sannyasi, I am this, I am that, on account of something. Huh? So that is called mithyatma. Sorry, that is called gaunatma. You have taken the attribute of a wife and call yourself a husband. You have taken the call it, you have got identified with something. And the second one is mithya. Mithya is you have forgotten your original nature and you are calling yourself to be the body, breath, mind, intellect, equipment. Having taken this position as individual, then you continue projecting that I am this, I am that, I am this, I am that. Your habit is there, I am this, I am that. Whole life you are taking some position or the other. Same habit the scriptures are taking and saying, you are that. They're saying, don't associate yourself with anything in this world and say, I am this, I am that. No. You are that immaculate one. You are that Atman. You are that infinite consciousness. You are feeling that you are the waking dream, deep sleep. No, you are the one who illuminates the waker, dreamer and deep sleeper. Take that position. You are that one. Don't be at the mercy of the waking world, dream world and the deep sleep world. That has only happened because of your identification with the equipment. You are that, you are that. And when his attention becomes steady on this atmic principle, on this Atman, then what is the... It's called prajnanam. I am Atma Brahma. He comes to this conviction that this Atma alone is the Self, is the infinite. Then the third one is consciousness is Brahman. So first, the Atma is Brahman. It's an intellectual message that is given to him. And then this consciousness that you are, that is Brahman, prajnanam Brahma. There are four Mahavakyas. Tattvamasi, I am Atma Brahma, Prajnanam Brahma and Aham Brahmasmi. They are the main four ones. There are many others, but just we take the four. And then it is told, when he hears this Atma that I am, that is of the nature of Brahman, this conscious, oh really? And then Atma, where is Atma, where is Atma? Consciousness. Are you conscious? Yes. This consciousness is the Atma and it is of the nature of Brahman. And first it was told, you are that. What is that? That is that Brahman. And who are you? First you recognize that you are the conscious principle. Then you recognize that you are the Atman, which is the self-illumined principle. And then this self-illumined principle itself is that infinite principle. So it's a journey within yourself. You're taking the power back. We are conscious of everything in this world, isn't it? I'm conscious of you, I'm conscious of God. So this consciousness is actually that reality. What is this consciousness? Oh, this consciousness is the Atma, the source. It is the illuminator. It is in its light, everything is being known. What is that known? Good question. Start discarding everything that is temporary, everything that is living on borrowed energy. Start discarding. That is the neti neti. And come to this atmic principle. And in this way, once we do the neti neti, when one has realized the that there is nothing else to be discarded. When one comes to this point that there is nothing else to be discarded, there you are. And this way, these Mahavakyas, when they are contemplated upon, what their import is, what they are pregnant with suggestion to bring your attention to that, and when we contemplate on them, eventually we come to realize Aham Brahmasmi, I am that reality. And this is initially it may be a thought knowledge, but that thought knowledge is talking about that eternal self, and eventually this thought also goes away, because thought must illuminate something. If I say Anjali, it must illuminate some person. If I say camera, there is a corresponding form that comes with it. If I say a table, there is a corresponding form with that word, that thought which is erupting in the mind. When we say Brahman, there is no form coming in the mind. Before, when I used to say I, the body form used to come. In the meditation, when I used to say I, it was associating with the thoughts or the experiences. Systematically, I have discarded, I have sublimated, dissolved everything that this I was associated with. What is this I indicating? What is this I? The intellect cannot come to know. All it can do is contemplate, but it can never come to know, because just like body cannot come to know, breath cannot come to know the I, the erratic mind cannot come to know, so also the subtlest of subtle, the intellect, which has the capacity to peep into the unknown, to imagine, to seek, it also cannot come to know that which is illuminating it. And in this way, through the process of negation of the conditionings, the upadhis, and by taking the support of the scriptural statements, the union, it is not a journey. The individual self is being instructed. You are the infinite self. A wave is being instructed. You are the water. Why the wave is not realizing water? For all, everything is telling you, sir, is that not a foolish instruction to the wave? That wave, you are water. But wave does not know that. It is seeking the infinite waters. Why? Its attention is on its form. Whether that form is of the body or of the breath or of the thoughts. But it is its attention is on the form. It must unclutch itself from the form. Continuing,
avidyakam shariradi drushyam budbudavatksharam एतद् विलक्षणं विद्यात् अहं ब्रह्मेति निर्मलम्। The body, etc., up to the causal body, ignorance, which are objects perceived, are as perishable as bubbles. Realize through discrimination that I am the pure Brahman, ever completely separate from all these. See? Gross body, subtle body, causal body. All of them are like bubbles on the water, meaning appearing to be separate from the infinite. Aham Brahmeti Nirmalam, the pure Brahman, who can contemplate Aham Brahmeti Nirmalam? Mala means dirt, nirmala without dirt of objectivity. Who can come to this conclusion, aham brahmeti nirmalam, I am the Brahman, without any doubt, without any objectification? Only Uttam Adhikari can come to know this, who is absolutely alert, who is absolutely subjective in his approach. Uttam Adhikari does not mean the one who wears special clothes or marks and goes to temple every day and reads scripture every day. There are many people who read scriptures. Qualification of a seeker is directly proportional to his subjectivity of approach. Who is Adham Adhikari, the lower one, whose attention is still on the world or on the mind? Who is Madhyam Adhikari, whose attention is more on the mind, less on the world, and some inkling about the self? Who is Uttam Adhikari, whose attention is only on the self, absolutely none on the world, and little bit on the mind? This is Uttam Adhikari. So where is the shift? Shift is, are you extroverted or introverted? But how will I live like this, being introverted? Let the senses be extroverted, how does it matter? You don't become, you remain in that poise all the time. And how does this come about? How this shift comes about? It is told, seek out company of saints and sages, be in regular satsang. And while you are studying, going to satsangs, being in the company of saints and sages, all the time you cannot be hanging around them. When you are on your own, do some practices by which you can dissolve the subconscious impressions. Do japa sadhana, take some contemplation, do some pranayam, yoga abhyas, which will help in reducing the impact of the matter equipments. Calm them down. Yama, niyama, asana, pranayam, pratyahar, dharana, dhyan, samadhi. This has to be done in your own free time, regularly. Contemplation. Do japa. Chant loudly. Chant softly. Automatically it will become soft. Automatically it will take you into meditation. But sitting in front of saints and sages, please deliver me, please deliver me, please deliver me, he can't do anything. He can give you instructions. The growth The shift has to happen within. Scriptures cannot do anything. They can only keep declaring what the truth is, indicating what the truth is. And what is their instruction? You are that. But can you give me something simpler? Just by telling this is not enough. It is a subjective approach. And it becomes available to us the calmer we are in ourselves. The calmer the mind is, the more is the effulgence available to us. The more the closer we are to it. So, and automatically, you know, when we go to satsangs, when we go to saints and sages, we are doing the sadhana of purification of the mind. We are not automatically one must live a life of dharma, or starts living a life of dharma. He starts doing what is right. That is what Yamaniyam is. He does not interact in the world to manipulate, or you know, to be jealous or to be envious or to impose his will. No, he is there. Theek hai, everything is okay. He is doing his duties. He is doing what is right. Being righteous is very important. And when we start doing that, then automatically the next stage of following dharma in our life will lead to this conclusion that I can be doing all my life, but this is not the solution. My doing must shift away from the world into something else. Because we are addicted to doing, isn't it? So we were living at the mercy of the world. Now we are doing the righteous, we are corrected, we have become integrated, we are doing the right thing that must be done. We are alertly doing everything. And you realize that even though doing the puja, archa, chanting, going to temples, going on pilgrimages, not lying, hygiene, this, that, all this, how much energy is expending in that, you know? Bhavre. You give donations to the schools, to the charities, blah, blah, so many things you are doing, involving. Go to bless the children who are born, go to this, go. But it's still, it's good that you are doing it, but it is not, but there is still emptiness inside. And when you come to this realization, no amount of my doing in this world is going to be enough. Where was our attention before? On the world. Our equipments are addicted to activity. So now, instead of the addiction to the world and coming to this realization that this world is like this only, it's okay. Let me use this energy which I was expending outside, let me use it for purifying myself. And then the yoga begins, then the pranayama begins. Then the kriya begins. And as you are purifying, you are going in within and more within and more, from gross to subtle, within yourself. So as long as your attention is on the body, you cannot think of meditation. You will only think of asanas. Then you come to realize, asanas, what is, how many, whole life I am going to take only, do the animal poses all the life, but I am a human being. Why am I doing animal poses all the time? Oh, for the channels to open up, this, that. But they said, I am the Atma, which channel I have to open up? When this rises, then you automatically, then information will come to you. Don't worry. Asana is supposed to be done so that we can sit for 2-3 hours without any disturbance. If that is happening, drop everything else. You are not here to increase health of the body. You are here to realize the self. The ultimate health is being the self, isn't it? Then when that happens, obsession with the body goes away. Next, what is next? Prana, breath. Automatically pranayama begins. When too much pranayama is done, hunger is there. And then that becomes a problem. If you eat, then on the seat of meditation, you will feel uncomfortable. You will want to go to toilet or loo, disturbance. Then, because the approach was not subjective, it was objective. You are extrovert before towards the world, then now you are extrovert towards the body, but you have given less value to the world. Now you are giving less value to the body, but you are extroverted towards the breath. Then you realize, arey yaar, ye kab tak chalega aise, iska toh koi end hi nahi hai. But if you keep the pranayama on, and if you are subjective, alert, you will feel a throb within your body, within yourself. This throb is the throb of the whole universe, the cosmos. Catch that throb. Not the heartbeat, is the throb, apart from the heartbeat. Catch that throb. Automatically the mind becomes focused on it. And then you realize, this throb is also known by me. So once you have become focused on the throb, to the exclusion of everything else, the world is not disturbing you, the body is not disturbing you, the breath is not disturbing you, your attention is only on that throb. So, then, initially the throb may be bang, 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 it becomes less and less, then there is gap between the throb also. Then automatically, what here is being told, that who is knowing this throb, this will become self-evident. Then that throb is also dissolves away and you fall back into yourself. This is required to be done. So one must realize that the gross, causal and subtle, they are like bubbles. They are existing temporarily only to go out of manifestation after some time. Don't give too much value to anything in life other than the Atma. Our convictions, our dispositions, our feelings about something, about someone, we become so obsessed with it. I gave the example of a sannyasi. Someone is a pujari, someone is, I belong to the Shankaracharya tradition, I belong to the Nath Sampradaya, I belong to this ashram, I belong to that ashram. What subjectivity they have started, journey they are on? Nothing. They are still identified with something outside. Our main focus should be the self, nothing but the self. initially we feel and we come to know that there is a journey. Oh, I'm on a spiritual unfoldment journey. What is the journey? Journey is in the self, for the self, by the self. And when you come to the self, you realize there is no journey. Once you withdraw from the equipments, you realize there is no journey. You have always been, only imagining that you were not. And that was on account of our attention and value giving to the equipments, to the anatma. And in this way, come to the realization. See, who is Ishvara or Brahman and who is Jiva? I told yesterday, we talked about it. Just restate. Who is Jiva? At the mercy of his mind. Who is Ishvara? Master. Master of what? Mind is only as long as thoughts are there. Na? Thoughts can be of the world or thoughts can be coming from the subconscious impressions. Accumulated. Does Ishvara have accumulated impressions? No. Is Ishvara, can Ishvara think about the world through thoughts? Why? Because everything is he alone. So he doesn't have a mind. And who are we? Who has a mind? See? So come to that stage in yourself. This is the evolution. This is the evolution that is required. And if this is, so these lofty ideas have to be kept ever alive within ourselves. Because by default we keep thinking about the world, about this, we pass a comment about them, this person, that person, this situation, gossip, this, that. No. We must be inspired, so much inspired that these ideas, they automatically pop up all the time. So, with this, we are on verse 32. We'll start tomorrow. What is the process of negation? It was just mentioned here. What is this process of negation? In detail, it will be told from verse 32 till 37. Till 37. 32, 33, 34, 35. In 6 verses they will tell us. We'll look at it tomorrow. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha Harihi Om. Why is it not stopping?